Hi, everyone. My name is Claire Tomlin. I'm a professor of electrical engineering and computer sciences at Berkeley. And this is a series of modules that we're recording for the course EECS 221A, which is linear system theory at Berkeley. This is the 32nd module. And in this module, we're going to talk about exponential stability of linear time invariant systems. Okay, so in a previous module, we talked about the different definitions of stability, asymptotic stability, and exponential stability. So now we're going to launch right in and look at one of the cases. We're going to look at the linear time invariant case, so linear time invariant system. Again, we're going to ignore input since the internal stability depends on the state matrix A. And we're going to ask about exponential stability, or try to characterize what are the properties of the A matrix such that this system is exponentially stable. Okay, so the theorem that we're going to prove here is the following theorem, which is exponential stability of x dot equals ax. So the equilibrium at zero of that system is exponentially stable, ES for exponentially stable, if and only if all of the eigenvalues of the matrix A are in the open left half plane. So the spectrum of A is contained in the open left half plane. So it means that all of the eigenvalues have negative real parts. They're not allowed to be on the J omega axis. They have to be in the open left half plane. All right, so let's prove this. It's a very nice test because typically you're given the A matrix. It's not too hard to calculate its eigenvalues. And so just by looking at where its eigenvalues are, you can ask whether or not that system is exponentially stable. Okay, so our intuition behind proving this is that we know that x of t for this system is equal to e to the at times x0. Let's just suppose t0 is equal to 0. So we know that the norm of x of t is going to be less than or equal to the norm of e to the at times the norm of x0. And so in order to prove exponential stability, we go back to the definition of exponential stability, which says that the norm of x of t is bounded above by a decaying exponential characterized by parameters m and alpha, multiplied by the norm of the initial state. Okay, so our goal is to show that the norm of e to the at is less than or equal to m e to the minus alpha t. Okay, so if we can show this, then that allows us to show that the state trajectory converges to the equilibrium at zero according to a decaying exponential. Okay, so basically we're asking if the eigenvalues show that like the eigenvalues of A being in the open left half plane is equivalent to the norm of e to the at is bounded above by this decaying exponential. Okay. All right, so let's actually think about what e to the at looks like. Okay, so let's erase this. Keep that in mind and prove the theorem by writing out e to the at. So we know that e to the at, if we write it out, it's the following. It's going to be the summation from k equals 1 to n of polynomials, we'll call them pi k of t times e to the lambda kt, where the lambda k's from 1 to n are the eigenvalues of the matrix A. Okay, so this term here, I said it's a polynomial in time. It's indexed by k. So each mode, e to the lambda kt, has its associated polynomial in time, pi k of t, that pre-multiplies it. Okay, so if we think about how we compute e to the at, it's the inverse Laplace transform of si minus a inverse. And we've done that computation before. Basically, we compute si minus a, we compute its inverse, we perform partial fraction expansion to basically compute the inverse Laplace transform of that. And so these polynomials basically represent the polynomials that multiply the exponentials in the inverse Laplace transform. So they're going to be terms like kt, or, well, let's not use k because we're using k as our index. Terms like some constant ct, or some constant ct squared, or, you know, just some constant. So they're basically the coefficients of the exponentials in the inverse Laplace transform of the individual terms when we take the inverse Laplace transform of e to the at. So this is our general form. What's important here is that these are polynomials in time and these are exponentials. And we're if we're thinking about proving the theorem, assuming this and proving this in terms of the reverse direction proof, we're assuming that these lambda k's are all have negative real part. Okay, so these correspond to decaying exponentials. So with that representation of e to the at, then we can write it out as, okay, and actually, you know, I didn't specify this. So these are, if we think about, this is an n by n matrix, these are scalars. These are actually not only, they're not polynomials, they're matrices of polynomials. So each of the pi k of t is a matrix of polynomials, which are of the form, matrix of polynomials, which are of the form that we just mentioned. So they're like C, CT, CT squared, etc. Okay, so now if we look at now the norm of e to the AT, that's going to be less than or equal to the summation from k equals 1 up to n of norm pi k of t e to the real part of lambda k times t. So the imaginary part doesn't add anything to the norm. Okay, and so now that's less than or equal to, so we've got the norm of a matrix where the entries in that matrix are polynomial functions in time. So we can replace that with just some polynomial function pk of t e to the real part of lambda k t. And now I'm going to include everything in the summation and just bound that by some polynomial p of t e to the minus mu t. Okay, so these pk of t's are polynomials which bound the norm of the matrix polynomial. And then p of t is just the summation of from k equals 1 to n of all those individual pk's of t's. So it's just something that bounds this above if we do that over the summation. Mu is going to be the eigenvalue, it will be representative of the eigenvalue that's closest to the j omega axis, so the slowest decaying eigenvalue. So here, mu is going to be equal to negative of the maximum of the real part of lambda k for all lambda k which are in the spectrum of the matrix A. Okay, so it gives us, this is the, if we have a bunch of eigenvalues of the matrix A, so they're all in the open left half plane by hypothesis of our theorem, then mu is this one here, it's negative, so this is minus mu here. Okay, so mu is positive, minus mu is negative. Okay, and that's it's the real part here. So if this were imaginary, it would just be the real part of that eigenvalue. Okay, so it's the slowest decaying eigenvalues. It's a number which is to the right of all of the eigenvalues in the left half plane, but it's still mu is a positive number. Okay, so that's enough to establish a bound now. So we have a bound on e to the at. Let's just rewrite that up here. And we can use that for establishing the bound that we need for establishing exponential stability. Okay, so we've got the norm of e to the at is less than or equal to a polynomial in time, e to the minus mu t, where mu is greater than zero. Okay, so that's where we are. And now we can do a few things. This is a polynomial function in time. This is a decaying exponential. A polynomial grows faster than any a polynomial grows more slowly than an exponential does. So a decaying exponential will decay faster than that polynomial is growing. And it's that relationship that we can use to establish the required bound on the norm of e to the at. Okay, so basically what we can say, because P of t is a polynomial, we can say that for all epsilon, there exists some m, which may depend on epsilon, which is positive, such that P of t can be bounded between 0 and this m epsilon e to the epsilon t. Okay, so, and that should be P, absolute value of P of t. So it's basically saying that P of t is a polynomial, so it's not going to grow faster than any growing exponential, no matter how small epsilon is. And that's true for all t greater than or equal to t0, or in this case, 0. Okay, so that tells us that, therefore, for all epsilon, there exists some m of epsilon such that e to the at is less than or equal to m e to the, so I'm going to replace p of t with this exponential here, and I'll just choose this one, e to the minus mu minus epsilon t here. So this is true for all t greater than or equal to 0. All right, so we're almost done. We basically just have to show that mu minus epsilon is positive. This is our same m of epsilon. So we know that all the eigenvalues of A are in the open left half plane. So we know that mu is greater than 0. This statement is true for all epsilon. So in order to make this term here positive and make that whole thing decay, so mu minus epsilon positive, there's a negative sign, so this becomes a decaying exponential, we just have to choose epsilon to be between 0 and mu. So epsilon has to be between 0 and mu. Mu is given to us by the eigenvalues of the matrix A. And epsilon is something we can choose. And if this is the case, then we have that e to the at, the norm of e to the at, is bounded less than e to the minus alpha t, where alpha is equal to mu minus epsilon, and it's a positive number, which guarantees that the system is decaying. So therefore, we have that x of t is going to be less than or equal to m e to the minus alpha t times norm x0, and we get the result that we need. The system is exponentially stable. Okay, so what we've proven is that if the eigenvalues of the matrix A are all in the open left half plane, then the system is exponentially stable. Okay, so to show the other direction is also easy. So if we have that now, what we want to prove is that if the system is exponentially stable, then the eigenvalues of A are all in the open left half plane. So exponential stability implies eigenvalues of A in the open left half plane. So the way I would prove this is by contrapositive. So we'll prove it by showing that if at least one of the eigenvalues of the matrix A is not in the open left half plane, then the system is not exponentially stable. So we want to prove that if at least one eigenvalue of A is not in the open left half plane, so C0 minus, then XE is not exponentially stable. Okay, so that's equivalent to saying that exponential stability implies that all of the eigenvalues of A are in the open left half plane. Okay, so this is just the other direction of the proof. So we finished proving one direction here, and now we'll go on to this next direction. Well, this direction is fairly straightforward. We've already done the hard work. If at least one of the eigenvalues of the matrix A is not in the open left half plane, then what can happen? Then the matrix E to the AT, if we just compute the solution to that, which we know takes on the general form k equals 1 to n of pi k of t e to the lambda kt, then for that, let's suppose we have a particular lambda k which has zero or positive real part, then the solution corresponding that part of that summation corresponding to either e to the lambda k, where lambda k has real part which is either zero or positive, that does not decay to zero as t goes to infinity. And that means that the whole solution is not going to decay to zero as t goes to infinity. So all you need is one eigenvalue of A not being in the open left half plane to be able to get a solution which doesn't decay to zero as t goes to infinity. It's really that eigenvalue having negative real part which takes over the overall solution and makes sure it decays to zero. Okay, so that part is easy to prove, and we've basically proven the result now, which is that exponential stability of the system x dot equals ax is equivalent to saying that the eigenvalues of A are in the open left half plane. Okay, so that's a nice test. It's sort of the easiest test we can do. Just look at the eigenvalues of the matrix A. What happens if the system, can we come up with weaker characterizations for internal stability? As we know, for linear time invariant systems, exponential and asymptotic are the same. But what about stability? So we'll talk about tests for stability, and we'll relate this to bounded input, bounded output stability. So the relationship between internal and bounded input, bounded output stability in our next module. Thanks very much.